Creating with rice papers means you have pretty much unlimited options, since with the right adhesive, it can be applied to most surfaces. Brand new today are three styles designed by Elizabeth St. Hilaire. She sells Seashells, The Aquatic Life, and The Swimming Sea. As the name suggests, this collection is water-themed and features elements from the sea. Not only that, Elizabeth chose a pretty blue ultramarine color for the ink rather than black, making this group very unique. In today's video, I'll demo ways to add color and options for using these oh-so-pretty papers. There are three papers in this undersea themed collection from Elizabeth. The first one is Seashells. She sells seashells. I knew I was going to get my tongue twisted on that one. This is named The Aquatic Life. And then the final one is The Swimming Sea. They're beautiful just as they are. And I've got a couple of small projects started that I want to show you. So the first one, this is one of our number 12 tags. I adhered one of the rice papers to the front. You can see I haven't actually done anything to the back. I've got some color on the inside. So this will be my cover, front and back, and then I can bind some paper or some smaller tags in here. But you can see that I picked up on the aquatic or undersea themed with some elements from the art by Marlene, the most recent, the Golden Oldies XXL Ginormous Collector's Book. This was included in there, and then this is a card. Now you know that I don't generally make cards, but this was easy enough that even I could do it. This is one of our 4x6 index cards. I just adhered the rice paper to it and came in with some more of those undersea themed elements because it all fits together beautifully. Now you can alter the paper before you use it, which is what I did here. So this background on this tag is a piece of rice paper that I altered using Art Alchemy paint that was thinned with water. And the advantage to using paint is that once it dries, it's done. You don't have to worry about using a wet adhesive to put this paper in place and have anything change. Ink sprays are a different story, so you have to kind of think about that. For everything that I'm doing today, it is paint, and so I don't have to worry about that. The colors are unaffected by gel medium if I choose to use that, and of course if I use something dry like our sticky snippets, then that's even easier. So, with all of that said, let's talk about the most fundamental part about working with these papers, and that would be removing an image from them if you want to use a piece rather than an element rather than the entire piece. So I want to work with this fish at some point, and I could come in with scissors and cut it, and that works fine. That creates a nice hard line. But the other thing that I can do is put some water out here and take a brush. And I'm going to use water as kind of, whoops, well, that wasn't what I meant to do, but it really doesn't matter. You'll see that I can work around that. So I'm going to outline the fish with water, and I'm going to be careful when I do this that I don't tear into the fish itself. So let's just grab a paper towel and clean this up before I inadvertently set that in it. So I'm going to use my forefinger and thumb on my left hand because I'm right-handed, and I'm going to hold the design here with my thumb and forefinger outside of the design, so as I separate and the paper feathers, it feathers in the border or the area around the shape, in this case the fish, rather than pulling into the fish itself. So even though I have water where I didn't really mean to get it, it doesn't make a darn bit of difference because I can just gently ease this out, and once it dries, nobody's the wiser. So when you do it this way, as opposed to that hard edge you get with scissors, this gives you a really nice, soft, feathery edge. And this is particularly effective with gel medium because that gel medium will allow all of that feathery edge to kind of show. Now, I'm going to just take those words off because I really don't want that as part of the border. And you can see how easy it was to do that. So adhering rice paper to a surface is also actually pretty straightforward. You have two options. You have a wet adhesive like gel medium, and like a doofus, I put my bottle of gel medium away, but here it is. So this is Dina Wakely's gel medium, or you can use a dry adhesive like our sticky stuff. Either works, and in fact, someplace here, I have a piece of sticky stuff. The only thing that you have to keep in mind is that with sticky stuff, whoops, that's not what I meant to grab. With sticky stuff, it's kind of a one and done thing. You get a chance to put it down, and it better be the way that you want it. With gel medium, you have the option, you have a little bit of time to go ahead and move things around. So this is that fish that I showed you, or actually I didn't show you a moment ago, I meant to. So this was the fish that I originally planned to put on here. This is that tag that I did that I'd already altered the paper. This is our honeycomb white chipboard element. And then this was the fish that I planned to put on here, but it really blended in with the background too much, so I went with this white one instead. So I have this piece. I'm just going to grab, where'd that number five tag go? I'm just going to grab that number five tag and some gel medium, and let me go ahead and grab a brush, and I'm going to put it on there. So the thing with gel medium or any wet adhesive is that the more you use, the more buckling you're liable to see. So this isn't a very big area. I don't necessarily need to use a ton of adhesive here, and I'm not going to, because I know that if I do, then I'm going to get more buckling. That might have been not quite enough, because some of it obviously gets absorbed, or not absorbed, but it ends up in the bristles of the brush. So you just go ahead and put that nice thin layer down there, and then you apply your piece over the top. And I don't have enough gel medium on this brush. There we go. So you can see those feathery edges kind of hang out there. Now this is the edge of the paper, so there was no feathery stuff there, but that's fine, because when I get through with this, I'm going to cut it out. Let me just wet that brush so the gel medium doesn't dry. I'm going to cut this out pretty much just like this, and I'll take advantage of that cut edge. So we'll put that to one side. So sticky stuff is another option. This is one of our, this is a 6x12 sheet, and this is a 4x6 index card. So I'm going to grab some scissors, and I'm just going to hack a piece off here so I'm not working with the whole sheet, which I don't really need to do. And so I'll peel back the liner sheet, which exposes the adhesive, and then it'll stick to my fingers. And I'm just going to go ahead and put this down. That looks pretty good. I'll grab those same scissors and just trim the excess sticky stuff away. And I'm not going to do a very fancy job here. I'm just going to kind of do it and get it done. And then once this is trimmed, I'll come back. I'm going to burnish this with my fingers so that I get good adhesion between the sticky stuff and this index card. And then it's just a matter of peeling the release paper from the other side off, which exposes the adhesive, and now I'm ready to go. So I hadn't really given too much thought, but let's come in and let's grab, so I'm going to take advantage of the cut side here. I'm going to line that up with the edge of the index card and lay that down, and I'm also going to get some of the seahorse on there as well. So now this is already on and it's done. No warping because there's no wet adhesive. I'll just come back and trim this out. This is, it could be a page in a journal that I use that I bind index cards in. It could be another card front like what I did here. It's an index card. At this point it can be almost anything. So up next I'm going to show you how to add color to the rice paper using paint or something as interesting as a gel press plate. When you add color to the papers, you need to consider the opacity of the paint, which is what I use for everything you see here and all my other parts of the projects. Ink sprays tend to be transparent because they're a dye-based product, but with paint, most of which is designed to offer coverage and opacity, you're going to see some obscuring of the printed design. So the workaround is either to water it down, that will thin the opacity a bit, or if you're gel printing, you're going to apply a thinner layer. No matter what you do with certain kinds of paint, you are definitely going to see a little bit of obscuring of the design. Now, with that said, and let me just slide these out of the way for one second. When you look at something like the Amsterdam acrylic paints, when you look at these, you can see, let's actually put them in this way, in this order, because this is the in order from most transparent to least. So when you look at these containers, you'll notice that there's a little square right here. On this particular color, the square is just a line through it and it's empty, and that means that this is a transparent color. On this one, you can see that it's a half triangle, which means that this is a semi-opaque paint. And here where the square is completely filled in, that means that it's an opaque paint. So when you know this, you have some options for working. Now with something like the Art Alchemy paint, there's no notation on here, but because these have mica in them, now these are the sparks and the particles of mica are larger, and that's what gives it that sparkly appearance. But even with the Metalite, because you have pigment in there, mica, you're going to see more opacity. Again, you'll thin the paint with water, and you'll see some reduction in that opacity. I'm going to show you examples in one second. Even for something like the Fresco finish paint, Paper Artsy labels them as either opaque, semi-opaque, or transparent, so you have an indicator of what you're going to get when you look at them. So This is a sample that was made with Amsterdam acrylic paint, and I wet the paper and then I brushed the color on. Same thing here, except that if I hold this up, you can see the reflection in the light. That's because I used Art Alchemy paint. These happen to be Metalik. So you're going to get some coverage here that I saw less of here, even though I watered this down, watered both of them down, because of that mica that's in the Art Alchemy paint. When I gel printed, this is an example of a transparent paint, and you can see how little coverage of the printed design there is. This was an opaque paint, again, more coverage, and this was an Art Alchemy paint. This was a really thin layer. You can see the glimmer in there, but you can also see that there's some coverage. Now, there are some cases where this is exactly what you're looking for, so don't mentally label this as not good. It's simply a different option. So the easiest way to do this is to grab some paper, and I'm going to, well, I've got this partial sheet right here, so let's just go ahead and clip this piece off. So I'm going to show you what I do when I want to use water and paint and a brush, and that's probably the simplest. So I'm going to grab, what am I going to grab? I'm going to grab this transparent paint, and then I'm going to come in and grab, actually, you know what, let me take that back. I'm going to come in and grab the semi-opaque paint and the Art Alchemy paint, which I know for certain is going to be more opaque. I'm just going to put a little bit of paint down. I don't need, in fact, that's probably way more than what I needed. And then I'm going to take my Mr. Bottle, and I'm going to go ahead and do this. Now, the reason that I'm wetting the paper beforehand, and you don't have to, this promotes more wicking, more movement of the paint. I have that same brush again, so I'm going to come in, and I've got the brush, and I've now dipped it in water, and I'm going to come in, and I'm going to thin this paint out. And that's probably enough water for that entire blob of paint. I can always obviously add more water, but if it gets too thin, then I've got to come back and add more paint, and half the time that ends up being wasted. So there's that, and then I will put down just a little teeny bit of Art Alchemy, because we're not going to need that much. And that's way more than enough. All right, so let me wipe my hand, because I've already managed to get paint on myself. That seems to be my gift. So I'm going to come in, and I'm just going to very gently lay some color down. Now, I think that that's probably more than enough, because if I grab a little bit more water, I can blend this out, and I think that that's an ample amount of green. So I'm going to come back, and I'm just going to let this all brush blend together. I think it'll be fine that way. So not only am I adding color, I'm adding shimmer, because that's the nature of the Art Alchemy paint. This is, again, one of the sparks. But I think that this is a really interesting effect. Now, it's going to take some time for this to dry, but if I go ahead and hold this up, you can already see that there is definitely some more opacity that goes along with the sparks paint, but again, that is not necessarily a bad thing. All right, so let's go ahead and wipe this up. And now let's talk about, oh, you know what I want to do is I want to spatter. So if I come in, and I've got this wet, you know what, I'm not going to use that big brush, that's too big, and I have a piece here that's dry. So if I want to spatter this, wet means wicking, dry means less wicking, and in addition to that, I've already got some paint on here. So you know what, let's bring in another piece, let's do this on something that's wet, something that's got no color on it and is dry, and something that has color on it and is dry. I'm going to use, I shouldn't have wiped up that paint, but I'm going to use a little bit of the Art Alchemy paint, and I'm going to add some more water because I want to thin this out. It's going to spatter better if it's a little bit thinner. It doesn't need to be too thin. All right, so here we go. I'm just going to stick my finger out and tap the brush on there. And you can see that I've got speckles on here, but they are starting to wick a little bit. It's pretty subtle because these are small speckles. If I want to enhance that, if I want that to wick a little bit more, I just have to add some more water and it'll really start to cause that to move. Now, conversely, if I come in onto a very dry or a completely dry piece of paper, there's going to be virtually no wicking here because there's no water to make that happen. And if I come in here and I do it on something that's already got paint on it, then I'm going to have, again, no wicking because it's dry. So you can do all kinds of fun things. Now, if I really wanted to get crazy and spatter, I could really liquefy this paint. The thinner the paint is, the bigger the spatters tend to be. But I wanted to control this a little bit. I think that this looks fine just the way it is, and I especially like this because there's just that tiniest bit of wicking. So you'll find it interesting to know that my phone is off to the side, and it is now covered with turquoise spatters. That's not necessarily an awful thing. It's kind of an artist decoration to their equipment. All right, so now let's talk about what happens when you gel print. And I'm going to just bring these two samples back for one second. This was done with a transparent paint, and this was done with an opaque paint. The difference is obviously the opacity that is inherent to the paint, but the other piece of that that you can control is how thin a layer you put on. Now, in some cases, a super thin layer. All right, now I have the plate. A super thin layer is going to mean lighter coverage, and in some cases maybe no coverage at all. But again, that has its place. It kind of depends on what you're doing, whether you're aiming for a specific purpose or you're simply playing around. So this is an opaque paint. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to put some on this side, and that might be too much, but we'll see. And then I'm going to grab, this is another Sparks paint, and I'm just going to put a little bit on like that. I can always take it off if that's too much. So out comes my brayer, and I'm simply going to brayer these colors out. I'm going to brayer the blue out first, and I think that that's a little bit too much. So I'm going to go off to the side and brayer some of that off, because again, I need a nice thin layer here, or I'm going to end up with more coverage than what I expected. So that is thinning out now, and I'll come in and I'll do the green color. And I've got a little bit of blending going on here, but that's fine because I've got the sheen that goes along with the Art Alchemy paint. So I'm going to grab, this one is the Swimming Sea, and I'm just going to go ahead and put this on here and print. So we're going to get a different effect because this one is definitely more opaque, but you can see that this works just fine. So I have some color on there, I have some shimmer on there, I've pushed the elements to the back a little bit, but even with an opaque paint, because I was careful to not apply too much, I can still see these designs through there. The other thing that you can do is you can play around and you can put water on the back and you can push color through that way. If you do that with something like the Art Alchemy paint, the shimmer will be confined to the back, but you'll still get color that bleeds through the front. So these are Elizabeth's three brand new rice papers. This is the Swimming Sea, this is the Aquatic Life, and this one is She Sells Seashells. We have these sets, and we have Elizabeth's original two releases, U.S. Mail and Bees and Bugs, available now at joggles.com.